Welcome to NEB TV. Today I am joined by Tilda Carlo, who is the division head for our genome biology group here at NEB. Hi, Tilda.
Hi, Dina.
And we are talking about neglected tropical diseases and specifically NEB's research efforts in that area. So Tilda, how long has NEB been involved in parasitology research?
So NEB has been involved in parasitology research for actually almost 40 years, so not long after the company was founded. And it's largely the vision of our founder, Don Combe, who is a great scientist and humanitarian, who was traveling in the tropics and actually witnessed firsthand the suffering that was actually inflicted by these neglected tropical diseases, and decided that he would like to do something to help towards the control and treatment of these devastating infections.
And what are the goals of the program?
So the goals of the program are to conduct basic research on these tropical diseases, the parasites that actually cause these diseases, with the hope that this basic knowledge can then be translated into methods to actually control and treat the parasites in the tropics.
Mm-hmm. And what areas of research do you focus on?
So we focus on filarial worms in particular. These worms are responsible for a number of really devastating diseases, from lymphatic filariasis to river blindness or onchocerciasis, as well as a few other diseases which are also caused by filarial worms. Mm-hmm. All of these diseases are vector-borne diseases, so they are transmitted by a range of insects which are found throughout the tropics.
Today we will also be joined by Jeremy Foster, who is a research scientist here at NEB, and he will provide some more background on these filarial parasites. Then Tilda will come back and tell us about methods of detection. And lastly, we will hear from a researcher out in the field, and he's going to tell us a little bit about his work. Are you ready?
Yep.
All right, let's get started.
These diseases are caused by filarial nematodes, of which 8 species infect humans. Both lymphatic filariasis and onchocerciasis are found throughout tropical regions, where they threaten the well-being of about 20% of the world population. Lymphatic filariasis is caused by 3 species of worm, responsible for about 120 million infections in more than 80 countries. Onchocerciasis affects about 37 million people in 34 countries, mostly in Africa, but with smaller foci of disease also in South America. These diseases are amongst a group of 17 so-called neglected tropical diseases. Neglected because they don't kill as many people as other diseases such as malaria, and neglected because they're not problems of the Western world like HIV or TB. And a consequence of this is that they're also relatively neglected in terms of research funding. Although these parasites don't kill a great number of people, they cause an extreme amount of morbidity and disability, and are in fact ranked as the second leading cause of disability worldwide after mental health issues. These diseases are all transmitted by insects, various mosquito species for lymphatic filariasis, and black flies that breed in rivers and streams in the case of onchocerciasis. Lymphatic parasites cause long-term chronic infections, with about one-third of infected people showing clear clinical disease. The pathology results mostly from inflammatory responses to dead and dying worms that leads to lymph vessel damage and dysfunction, and eventually gross swelling of the limbs and genitals, accounting for the more common name of this disease, which is elephantiasis. In the case of onchocerciasis, adult worms live in subcutaneous layers under the skin and also in deeper tissues where they form nodules that can be seen and felt. Larval worms migrate away from these nodules into the skin, causing inflammatory-mediated skin disease and intense itching. Quite frequently, the larvae also migrate into the eye where they cause visual impairment and blindness, accounting for the more common name of this disease, which is river blindness. We believe that by fully uncovering the biology of these worms, especially their metabolic capabilities, we'll be able to find areas of their biology that are not shared with humans and that might then be developed as candidate drug targets for new treatments. Additionally, the genomes allow us to identify species-specific sequences for development of sensitive diagnostic assays. The diseases are treatable, but we really only have 3 drugs available. The drugs kill larval worms, but don't usually fully reverse the extreme symptoms. An exciting recent development has been the finding that antibiotics that target a bacterium which lives within the worm tissues and is essential for the worm's survival can also be used to successfully treat the diseases. Firstly, the available drugs have little activity against the long-lived adult worms, being mostly active against just the larval forms. This means that control is by repeated rounds of drug administration that need to be continued throughout the lifespan of the adult worms to prevent the presence of larval forms in the circulation or in the skin, thereby stopping transmission to other people. Additionally, there are recent reports that in some situations these drugs are not working as well as they used to, suggesting that a problem with resistance may be just around the corner. Also, using some of these drugs in patients who are co-infected with other parasites can cause serious adverse events, even death, and so this has limited their use in areas where the different species coexist. Fortunately, the new antibiotic treatments hold promise as they target both larval and adult worms, can be used in people co-infected with different parasite species, and they can be given as a single short course of antibiotic.
So for diagnosis of filariasis in humans, the way it's normally done is by collecting blood or skin from people and looking for the presence of baby worms. These are microfilaria, which circulate in the blood or skin. In the case of the blood-borne microfilaria, you will find that these microfilaria reach peak numbers in the circulation between 10 p.m. and 2 a.m. in the morning. So ideally, this is a time when one would go out and actually collect blood from people. So you can imagine that this is actually not a very popular technique. Once you have blood or skin from people, you look using a microscope for the presence of these small baby worms. It's actually very challenging to find these worms. It's very difficult to distinguish one type of worm from another. So there's a great need for improved, simpler methods that can be performed in the field with actually very few resources. There are various immunoassays which are available as an alternative to microscopy. However, most of these actually suffer from problems of cross-reactivity, problems with lack of sensitivity. PCR, or the polymerase chain reaction, is much more sensitive than the immunoassays and does not suffer from cross-reactivity issues. However, these assays tend to be quite difficult to perform, require a good amount of expertise as well as sophisticated equipment. LAMP is an alternative to PCR for the amplification of parasite DNA in blood or skin. It's a simple method that it can be performed isothermally in one step. And all you need is a water bath or a water heater and does not require the different cycles of temperature which is required for PCR. Colorimetric LAMP is a really nice option whereby you can actually determine if the parasite is present or not just by a simple color change in the tube. So colorimetric LAMP can be used to detect infection in both humans and the insect vectors. It can be used to distinguish people who may respond well to treatment versus those who may react badly to treatment. We can use the test to monitor infection in vectors to determine which areas that populations would be at risk of disease. So the next steps for our colorimetric LAMP assays are to transfer them to our colleagues who are working in areas where these diseases are endemic, to use them to determine which individuals would benefit most from treatment, and also to use them to monitor the insect populations to determine which areas are now at risk of disease. Also, they can be used to determine when is the best time to actually start the mass drug administration campaigns, which areas and when is an appropriate time to actually stop these types of treatments. So after mosquitoes, ticks are actually the second most important vector of infectious diseases, and they are responsible for a number of diseases actually worldwide. Locally, we have the deer tick, which is responsible for several really important diseases, including Lyme, babesia, anaplasmosis. So we have used the knowledge that we have gained from our research on neglected tropical diseases and transferred that to the development of similar colorimetric lamp-based assays for these various tick-borne diseases. So we hope that these assays will help to monitor the spread of these diseases, as well as eventually, hopefully, help in the control of these various tick-borne diseases, which are actually spreading throughout the United States, as well as the rest of the world.
I'm Professor Samuel Wanji, Head of the Department of Microbiology and Parasitology at the University of Boya in Cameroon. We have a large portfolio in filariasis research that involves working both in human and the vectors. So we look at the epidemiology in human population, we look at the transmission at the level of the vector, we look at the diagnosis in human, and we look at the experimental model in a small animal to see if we can develop model that can be used for drug screening. For the detection of filarial infection, we use both macroscopy and molecular biology techniques. And within the molecular biology techniques, we use qPCR and LAMP assays. LAMP assay is definitely more advantageous because not only is more sensitive, it's more specific, it's less time consuming. LAMP assay enables us to detect the infection both in human and in the vector.
So Tilda, thanks so much for joining me today.
You're welcome.
I find the whole topic really interesting and the research that you're doing is really great. But where can people go to learn more?
You can find out more on our website at neb.com by looking at the research department where our publications are listed, as well as on PubMed.
Okay, great. Thanks so much for joining us today. And if you have any suggestions for future episodes, please let us know.